So welcome to our online community that is with us watching on our YouTube channel today. We're so glad that you are here with us. And just a reminder that a little bit later in the service, we will be taking part in communion together. So you're more than welcome to do that at home. If you want to hit pause on your video now and gather some bread and cup, you can partake in that together with us. For those who might be watching at home and aren't my family or friends hitting the playback on YouTube, my name is Sarah Stevens, and I will be the guest speaker here for the next couple of weeks with you, and I'm grateful to be here, and I'm praying that you are blessed by today's service and that God will meet you in a special way today.
Thank you.
Before we dive into our message, I just have three short scriptures that I'll read to you this morning. The first one is from John 6:44. No one can come to me, Jesus says, unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. John 16:7-8. Jesus says, but very truly I tell you, it's for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. And then 1 Peter 3:15. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that is in you. But do this with gentleness and respect. Well, good morning, Pereaux Baptist Church. Thank you so much for having me with you as your guest speaker today and next week. I've been really looking forward to focusing on something other than baby these days, so it's been nice to have a little bit of work to do. Just a bit of background about me before we dive into the scripture today for our message. I'll just share with you briefly, I grew up in Burton, New Brunswick. Does anybody know where Burton is? You do? Oh, that's so cool. Normally I say Fredericton because it's about 20 minutes or so from Burton. And Burton, to give you an idea, if you've ever been out to Steam Mill area, it kind of reminds me of that, which is where I live now, which is funny. So it's a kind of a busy road, but in the woods, but you're close to civilization. So that's Burton. And about 20 minutes from Burton was Fredericton, where I went to St. Thomas University and studied right after high school, and I had plans of becoming a psychologist. So I took a Bachelor of Arts degree in psychology. And just for context for the story I'll share with you today, I didn't grow up in a Christian home, and we went to church a couple times, maybe for midnight mass. My parents were Catholic, but not practicing, if that makes sense. So we did that once in a blue moon. So that was my first and only exposure to church growing up. But then I met the Lord in 2008, and my life changed both instantly and gradually. I came to the Valley in 2010 after graduating with my BA in Psych and Religious Studies. And then I began my journey at Acadia Divinity College, and I was focusing in the area of prison ministry. I always had a heart for those who were marginalized, oppressed, on the outskirts, and that was where I was hoping the Lord was going to lead. As a requirement for Acadia, in our first and second year, we have to do something called mentored ministry. Have you heard of that before? Maybe you've had mentor ministry students here. So I was at Kentville Baptist doing my placement in the context of church, which I never thought I would do. The Lord has a funny sense of humor. And it was there that the Lord revealed to me as I preached my first sermon to Kentville Baptist that the people in the pews were just as broken and behind bars as people in jail. And it was then that my heart grew like the Grinch for the church. You should have that picture in your mind. Christmas is coming. My heart, not that I was grouchy towards the church, but my heart just grew for that type of ministry. And then I began to work for the past 10 years with children and youth and young adults and seniors from all walks of life in the church and outside of the church. And I am just so in awe of how God has worked all of that out in his awesome plan. And so because we don't know each other well, I thought I would just share a bit of my testimony with you today and then leave us with a challenge from Scripture. My journey with God began, as I said, when I was 19 years old. I was living at home and going to university. And if I can disclose some of my previous sin with you in that season of life before Christ, I really struggled with heavy drinking. I enjoyed a good club on the weekends. I participated in all kinds of awful things and unmentionable things that I'm so surprised to this day that God has redeemed me. That's all. I won't give you details. But that was my lifestyle. And I realize this isn't what you normally want to tell people on your first interaction with them when you're trying to make a good first impression, but I want to be transparent with you. I want to share with you where I came from so that you can give God all the glory to where he's brought me today. So please don't let that taint you, your first impression of me. That was my old life, and I was very lost, and I was very broken at the time. I also was struggling with depression and generalized anxiety disorder. I had been diagnosed with that and managed it with medication for 3 years. And then one day I woke up and my medication wasn't working anymore. And I began to feel worthless again. Lack of meaning, lack of purpose crept in. Panic attacks were on the rise. Feelings of doom and gloom and anxiety, these are all common things with generalized anxiety disorder. But along with all those overwhelming and terrifying feelings came big questions that were also overwhelming me that I could not shake. I began to ask, who is God? Is there a God? I've heard about God, but what is he like? What's the point to life? Is this all there is? Where did we all come from? What is going on with creation? It is marvelous. I was wrestling with these thoughts so much that I opened a phone book. I know, I didn't Google. I opened a phone book at 19. I had my first cell phone at 19, so that kind of dates a little bit. I opened a phone book. I began looking up names and numbers of churches in the Fredericton area. And as I made my list of churches to visit, I knew that I had the sense that I needed to talk to somebody who was religious, somebody who knew about this God that I heard about throughout my life. And I knew that if I went to my doctor, he would just up my medication and maybe think I was a little cuckoo. And so I didn't want to go down that avenue. And this is to say publicly, you should always seek your doctor. You should always see your psychologist. These are amazing things. But something was nudging me to check these questions out with someone who was spiritual. And so I went on my mission. I brought my friend, who was also named Sarah at the time. I walked in and I walked out of a few churches in Fredericton, just wasn't catching the right vibe or something. I was new to all this. I didn't really know what I was looking for, except that I needed answers. Finally, I got to the end of my list. I hadn't reached any pastor to talk with. I was getting pretty discouraged, and I was feeling pretty helpless at this point. Finally, I got a hold of somebody on the other line. And I felt like a fool, and yet I felt like I needed to keep on seeking. I think scripture tells us to keep searching, keep seeking, keep knocking. Some force that I couldn't describe was dragging me along, it felt like, pushing me into the direction I didn't understand what or why when I went anyway. Finally, I reached a pastor on the other end of the phone named Scott Wood, and I said something like this: I don't know what's going on with me, I'm sobbing on the phone, but I really need to talk to somebody who knows God. Can we talk? Here's the questions I have. Here's what I'm wrestling with. And he was very sympathetic and said, come into the office tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. and we'll talk. And so that's what me and my friend Sarah did. When I sat down with him, with my friend by my side, he began to read me scripture from the Bible. And you know the verses in Hebrews that tells you that scripture is alive and active? Well, that's what it felt like that day. It felt like in the moment that he was reading the words of God to me, they were jumping off the page and just hitting my spirit, like, this is truth. That's why I said to him in the office, this is what I've been looking for. And I was so excited, and I believed that Jesus was who he said to be, that he died for my sins, that he rose from the dead, and that he's alive today. And so Pastor Scott said, this is any pastor's dream, right? This random person off the street in your office, ready to receive Christ. He said, do you want to become a Christian? And I said, yes, how do you do that? And so I confessed Jesus as Lord that day. And I believed in my heart that he rose from the dead. In my prayer to God that day, I also said something like this to Jesus. God, I can't handle this depression anymore, and I can't handle this anxiety. I need you to take it away from me. And after I was done praying, I looked up at my friend, and she said, Sarah, you look like you are glowing. And I felt like a ton of weight had just lifted off of my shoulders that day. And I remember wanting to hold a megaphone over the world and just yell, look what Jesus can do. He can save you. He's alive. He is risen. The Bible is real. And this began my passion for evangelism and outreach ministry, which I'm still doing 10 years later online as well. God is so powerful and so present with us. God not only saved me that day from the penalty of my sin, but he healed me from my depression and my anxiety disorder, and I never had to take a pill again. It was a miracle. When I look at what happened in my journey to God, I see it explained in our scripture today. John 6:44 that I read for us says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. Well, when you deep dive into the word draw, it means to pull, to lead, and even to drag with force. The Father was drawing me, I felt, to himself, which I couldn't put into words then, but realize now. And I believe that God put those big questions in my mind and on my heart, that I would go seeking and searching. I believe that God led me specifically to Pastor Scott to hear the truth and to find salvation in Jesus. When you think of your salvation story, how has the Father pulled you along to meet with him for the first time? What people or circumstances did the Father use to lead you to his truth of his salvation? Maybe it was through a family member. Maybe you grew up in the church. Maybe a friend or a church event, or maybe something really random happened that the Holy Spirit just took you by the hand and helped you along to the saving grace of Jesus. From John 16, verses 7 through 8, we saw that Jesus told his disciples that he's going to send the Helper, in some translations, and ours today I think it said the Advocate, that when he comes, the Helper will convict the world of their sin. He will guide us into the truth of Christ. Well, the Helper here, the Holy Spirit, that Jesus says he will send, we see throughout the New Testament, he does a lot of things. He encourages us. He mediates on our behalf. He consoles and comforts us. He convicts us of our sin. And he helps us to come into the truth of Jesus. He helps us read the Bible too. Again, as I look back to how I was feeling pulled and led by God to know more about him, I felt lighter. I felt excited. I felt encouraged and comforted by the hearing the truth of God's word that I now know was the Spirit of God drawing me to himself, as Jesus described for us in John. How has God been a comfort to you over the years? What has he been trying to get your attention on, maybe even lately, when it comes to sin in our lives? Are there areas in your heart right now that God would like to spend time in bringing his truth and helping you back on his path so that we can live according to his Spirit and not our own desires? We see other examples from the Old Testament of God drawing people to himself. Jeremiah 31, God says to his people, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have drawn you with loving kindness. The promise here was that Israel's mourning would turn into joy. Time and time again, we see the people of God walking away and worshiping idols and living in sin, and God being ever so patient and kind and parent-like with them. Hosea 11:4 says, I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them, the Lord said, and fed them. Have you ever lifted a baby or a small child to your cheek to embrace them with love? It's okay, you can say yes or no. You can talk during the sermon if you want. Yes, I do this often with my new daughter, Ellie, who's not feeling well today. That's why she's not here. I'm really grateful for her. I think she has just a bad cold. But I do this often with Ellie. And she has the sweetest smile and the biggest, sweetest little cheeks that are also big, which is funny, right? Baby has they have the smallest faces, but the biggest cheeks sometimes. But I lift her to my face to show her affection and embrace her. I want to create that closeness with her. And I have a bond that just comes naturally flowing out of my love for her. And we see this in scripture that the Father does this to his people. And so we see this beautiful embrace, not only to people in the Old Testament, but also for those who become his children today, as Paul writes in the letter to the Romans, when we receive Christ as our Lord and Savior. Our psalm that was read for us earlier ties in with this very imagery as well. 103 verses 3 to 4. Bless the Lord, O my soul, who pardons all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with loving kindness and compassion. God did all of those things for me that day that I received his one and only Son. And I share my story with you this morning, not only to tell you of God's good works, or so that you can get to know me a little better, but to encourage you to be thinking about how the Father has embraced you, how the Father has blessed you, how he has pardoned your sin, how he has helped heal you and redeem you, how he has picked you up from the pit. How has God shown you his loving kindness and compassion over the years of walking with him as your Lord and Savior? Psalm 103:8 told us that the Lord is slow to anger, in verse 10, has not dealt with us according to our sins, but rather, in verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, has removed our transgressions from us. Verse 13, just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he himself knows our frame and is mindful that we are but dust. God doesn't deal with us as we deserve, but rather as a loving Father who knows that we are weak, who knows that we're in need of a Savior. And so I'm grateful this morning as we think about our own stories of how God led us to himself, and as we partake in communion together and are reminded of Jesus being the love of God in action for us. Philippians 2 tells us that though Jesus was God, he chose to empty himself and come from heaven to be payment for our sin. And so as I end the passage this morning, my challenge from scripture for us is twofold today. Number one, I encourage us, and I'll do it with you too this week, to sit with Psalm 103 again and reflect on the verses that we talked about, have the imagery in mind that we talked about of the Father holding us close to him, embracing us. The questions that arise from Psalm 103, how do we see God come alive from Psalm 103 in our story? And the second challenge is, how can we now give an account to others, as we heard from 1 Peter 3:15, sharing with us for what we believe in. We need to give a hope to others from what we have experienced from God. And so, very practically speaking, as Thanksgiving arises, just next week already, and maybe we gather with friends and family, how might we share how God has been good to us? Or maybe at your local store or your coffee shops you visit, your various appointments and schedules this week, how can we share our faith with others as we reflect on our own testimonies and the sacrifice that Christ became for us? Amen. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." I'll invite Deacon Paula to give thanks for the bread. Let's pray.
God, thank you for giving the most precious gift, your very own Son, so we can live each day with you. Lord, as we prepare to eat this bread that symbolizes your body, help us to relax in your healing, loving presence. Mm-hmm. Let us be still while you transform our hearts and our minds. Mm-hmm. Teach us to let go of our cares and worries so we can focus on you and receive your peace. Fill us with new life, Lord, filled with your Holy Spirit, with the desire to do your will in every thought, word, and action. Open our eyes to the truth that you are God, a living God who loves us and will be with us forever. Amen.
Let us eat this bread in remembrance of Christ's sacrifice for us. Jesus took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." I'll invite Deacon Amy to give thanks for the cup. Let us open our hearts to prayer. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to gather with each other as we worship you. We are so blessed to be the children of such a loving God. You love us no matter what mistakes we make and through all our failures. You give us everlasting hope through the hard times, leading us to joy and eternal life. Thank you for giving us your only Son, Jesus, who showed us that we are forgiven our sins and special to you. We thank Jesus for the gift of the cup, that we may always be reminded of his sacrifice for us. Please help us to always try and follow the example of Jesus, of living right, and help us to do so with your love in our hearts. Amen. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and may we be eternally thankful. Scripture tells us that after supper they enjoyed a hymn together, and then they went out. So let's stand and sing our closing hymn today. as you go, know this. In grace, you were created. In mercy, you have been sustained. In love, you will be held forever. Amen.